presentation of telling the story. We are so happy to finally be able to perform this show for you. And it's so exciting to see so many of you that I recognize your faces, that you've been to our other shows and supported us. And we really are happy to see you here. My name is Mary Jean Hansen, and I have the boring duty of giving you your instructions. The exits. There's an exit to my left here. Should something start happening and we have to vacate the room, out that way, right? There's an exit this way. You go out that door and you would go this way out. And those of you closer to the back, you have three entrances. You go out that way and then go out the door as you came in. Easy? Washrooms are to your left if you should need one. Oh yes, please make sure your cell phones are on silent. And thank you for wearing your masks into the auditorium. If you would like to remove your mask during the performance, and the people around you are okay with that, then you may do so. But please, when you get up to go out to bridge a mission, or when it's time to leave, put that mask back on. That is part of the COVID protocol of this church. And we thank you for honoring. Thank you very much. As you may have guessed, I am the director of this group.
Mary Jean, I just want to give a little cheer to you. Here's to you, and here's to me. And if we should ever disagree, we'll listen to you and not to me.
This church is kind enough to let us practice here, as well as use their facility, as well as their expertise of the people from the church for the sound system. To produce a show like this requires a real team effort, involving many people on and off the stage. So I would like to thank our sound and tech support, Jean, back there, and Jim Smith. And Doug Jackson, who has helped us with every single show we have produced. I'm going to introduce for you the teams that make up Synergy 150, because we are a team. So, we have the choir, whose names are listed on the back of your program, and they're divided into four sections.
Tenors.
So.
also very fortunate to have an absolutely gifted music team. Lois Wellington is our... our very talented pianist has been with us from the beginning, and we would be lost without her. Millie Besker is on the drumba! Millie has been providing a steady beat for us since 2019, and we really depend upon her percussion expertise. Pam C. McLean. One of our sopranos has added another musical element with her. And tucked back in by our castle, in case you didn't know, that's a castle tower. By our castle tower is Tim Lye Smith, who is a recent addition to our team and a recent addition to Canada. He plays many instruments, but has expertly filled out our bottom end with his bass guitar. The music team. We have another team member who doesn't get in the limelight much, but Barb Young, has basically this concert, she's been our ticket master, a challenging position. She liaisons with our treasurer, Randy Alexander, another volunteer in our choir. And she has kept track of all the money with the help of another choir member, our treasurer's wife. We like to keep it in the family. She designed our advertising posters and the program that you have in hand. Barb, we really thank you. I won't go into all the other things you do because we could stand here all night. But without you, I'd be lost. And now I will turn the program over to our narration team. Colleen Rush will be our number three narrator today. Colleen has been with us and narrating since we started doing the shows in 2017. A new person to our team is Dennis Vandenberg. And oh, I should mention, Dennis here is our own coronation baby. Oh. He was born on the Queen's coronation, so guess what? Today's his birthday. Sharon also has done all the research for me so that I could write the narration for the program tonight. She saved me weeks, if not months. So Sharon is our number one.
Are any of you good storytellers? I bet there are lots of you who are. What about listening to stories? You like listening to them? I'm sure you do. Stories are an important part of our culture. In fact, a very important part. And we, Synergy 150, we believe music is the best storyteller of all. So music has been an important part of our culture as well. And through it, we connect and we interact with music on a daily basis. And it is important then that throughout history, music has been used to tell the stories that affect our lives and the lives of those around us.
There are many different kinds of music, and some people identify with one more than the other. But tonight, Tonight, we are concentrating on the stories that are told through various styles of music.
As you may have guessed by our entrance music played by, this is Terry Stone here, Terry Mills, thank you, Terry, our talented bagpiper, we are starting our program with Celtic music. Now, what countries do you think of when you hear the word Celtic? Ireland, Scotland, both lands have produced well-known distinctive styles using instruments, such as the harp, the bagpipe,
the fiddle,
the flute,
a tin whistle,
and even a drum.
Our opening number is a traditional Scottish song written about the escape from Scotland of Charles Edward Stuart in 1746.
Wasn't he called Bonnie Prince Charlie?
Yes, he was. And he had led a Scottish uprising against the British, but was soundly defeated at the Battle of Culloden. Is it a tale with political intrigue? Oh, yes. And escape? Ooh, even more interesting.
The story tells us about a young woman named Flora MacDonald, who helped Bonnie Prince Charlie evade British government troops. She disguised the young heir to the abolished Scottish throne as an Irish woman, and then helped him to obtain a boat to take him across sea to the Isle of Skye and from there to France.
Now just imagine the roaring waves tossing this little boat as the thunderstorms rend the air. Picture a young Flora MacDonald trying to calm the frightened prince.
Tells a story about love and courtship. The lover in this story
make some grand promises, and asks his love, will ye go, lassie, go? What do you think this answer will be?
Thank you.
20s and 30s, a new genre of music emerged.
Pursuing his musical career, and he was heard to say, "But honey, you were always on my mind." At some point in our lives, I'm sure every one of us could identify with the story of this song.
I'm
singer, songwriter, actor, record producer, and entrepreneur. His version was a number one country hit and made its way to the pop charts at a time when country songs rarely crossed over. It's become one of Roger's most enduring hits and is considered his signature song.
Listen to the story of a late night meeting on a train bound for nowhere between a man known only as the Gambler and a narrator who is out of aces or down on his luck. The Gambler offers the narrator some worldly advice in exchange for his last swallow of whiskey and a cigarette.
I think we all can feel a little insecure from time to time.
listen to the song, see what you think.
Take Me Home Country Roads, released in 1971, is symbolic of West Virginia, which is described as almost heaven. It became one of our four official state anthems, and the Mountain State Brewing Company, which produces an amber ale called Almost Heaven, says it is named after Denver's Country Roads song. Thank God I'm a country boy, tells a story about life on the farm. The choir will now sing a medley of these three songs.
Yeah!
Thank you.
Cease and give a name to all the future, and we could call it peace.
And if peace is what we pray for, and peace is what we give,
then peace will be the way we are, and peace the way we live.
Yes, there still is the time to turn around and make all hatred cease.
And give another name to living,
and we can call it peace. In the song, Steal Away to Jesus, the words, "I ain't got long to stay here," seem to symbolize optimism for a better life for slaves by dying and going to heaven. But could it also be referring to a means of escape to freedom? What do you think? Listen carefully.
Steal away to Jesus. Israelites' captivity and the slaves' bondage in the American South was transparently obvious in the spiritual, "Go Down, Moses." This song, with its insistent refrain, "Let my people go," sent a message so obvious to white authorities that the song was banned in many areas. Following the British Emancipation Act of 1830, and with the support of the abolitionist movement, the hope of stealing away found expression in the flight to the North and to Canada by means of the Underground Railroad.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're great singers, you know. Really good. We enjoyed that. Sacred music has been a vibrant part of North American culture, from the earliest oral traditions of indigenous peoples through the written traditions of the first European colonists. The major storyline of Christian music is basically a message that forgiveness and redemption are possible regardless of sins committed, and the soul can be delivered from despair through the mercy of God. No song or hymn has expressed this message better than Amazing Grace, written in 1772 by John Newton. Amazing Grace is one of the most recognizable songs in the English-speaking world. A Newton biographer estimates that the song is performed about 10 million times a year. Hard to believe, right?
Oh, I think our choir has done it that often.
John Newton grew up without any particular religious conviction. His mother died when he was 7, and he was shipped off to boarding school for 2 years. Before going to live with his father and his father's new wife. At age 11, he went to sea with his father and sailed 6 voyages before his father retired in 1742. At that time, Newton signed on with a merchant slaving ship, and in 1743, while going to visit friends, Newton was captured and pressed into the naval service by the Royal Navy. He was such a problem on board that the crew left him in Africa.
Well, he did manage to find passage back to Britain on another slave trade ship and became involved in the Atlantic slave trade. Apparently, in 1748, a violent storm battered his vessel off the coast of Ireland so severely that he called out to God for mercy. This moment marked his spiritual conversion. And about 5 years later, he ended his seafaring altogether and became a minister and an abolitionist. Newton became a mentor and an ally to William Wilberforce, who was the leader of the parliamentary campaign to abolish the African slave trade.
Now, the movie Amazing Grace, you may have heard of it. It was a 2006 British-American biographical drama about the campaign led by this William Wilberforce that they've just mentioned, against the slave trade in the British Empire. The movie title is a reference to Newton's hymn, Amazing Grace, which you've all heard, I'm sure. Chris Tomlin, though, a worship leader in the US, was asked to add something to Newton's hymn, Amazing Grace, and to make it part of the movie. And after researching John Newton's life, and what you've heard about his life, all the slave trade and the boat and being kept in Africa and everything, you can understand why he wrote, Amazing Grace, my chains are gone.
Garricks lived from 1910 to 1977. He was a Baptist preacher, choir director, and a composer. His basic reason for writing the song, "Lord, I Know I've Been Changed," in the traditional spiritual format, was to inspire his fellow poor black church members during the Great Depression.
Need of mercy.
exit first, thank you. Please remember to put on your mask.
For our next musical story, we ask you to imagine you're sitting at an outdoor cafe in the 1920s. It's hot and steaming. And as you use your napkin to wipe the sweat from your eyes, you hear a new kind of music emerging, one that combines both blues and ragtime and has a plaintive melody. What kind of music do you think it is? It's a step. That's great audience participation. It's a style that's linked to both the African spirituals and Celtic American heritage. So, any guesses?
Yes.
Boring. That's right, it's jazz.
Summertime, written by George Gershwin in 1934 for his opera Porgy and Bess, was relatively unknown for 23 years, can you believe it, until the release of Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong's jazz album in 1957. Fitzgerald quickly propelled this song into the limelight, cementing it as a jazz staple, and also as a globally recognizable hit. But it is the song's story that is so compelling and draws you in. A story told by a mother in the sweltering heat of the deep south, singing a lullaby to her baby.
Thank you.
Classical music is a very broad reference to music, which is primarily a written tradition that evolved over many years, dating from the medieval era, around 500, and lasting to the romantic era, around 1900.
Now, do you realize that that's almost 1500 years?
Yes. And just like today, the music was based on people, their stories, and society's influences.
The Baroque era is considered one of the richest and most diverse periods in music history. During this time period, composers in Germany, like Bach and Handel, and composers in Italy, like Vivaldi and Corelli, experimented with finding a fuller sound for each instrumental part, thus creating the orchestra.
Italy played a vital role in the development of such musical forms as cantata, concerto, sonata, oratorio, and opera. And don't ask me what each of those terms means. You'll find out later. But basically, Baroque music was a tool for expression, not communication.
Antonio Vivaldi, an Italian composer born in Venice in 1678, died penniless in Vienna in 1741. He composed 500 concertos, 46 operas, 73 sonatas, chamber music, and a small number of sacred compositions. Gloria is considered his most famous choral piece.
The history of this song, rather than the words, is where we find an interesting story. Gloria, written in 1715, lay undiscovered for over 200 years, buried among a pile of forgotten Vivaldi manuscripts. It was not until 1957 that the familiar version, the one we will now sing, was published and given its first performance.
Thank you.
Buffalo Meal is a Neapolitan dialect song, not an Italian dialect, composed by Giovanni Capur during the Romantic era in 1898. Apparently, the lyrics were inspired by a particularly radiant sunrise over the Black Sea. Take a look at the translated words for this song as the choir sings it for you.
King of Rock?
Well, I remember a story about Elvis hearing that song when he was stationed in Germany with the U.S. Army in the late 1950s. I think when he returned to the States, he requested that new lyrics be written for that song, especially for him. Now, what was it called? It's Now or Never. I remember when he released that song in 1960, it was considered one of the best-selling singles of all time, with over 5 million copies sold.
And its instrumentation from jazz and rock music.
It's orchestration from classical music.
It's tempo from dance music, and it's backing from electronic music.
So you see, it really sums up all the genres of music that we have performed for you tonight.
So, who is considered to be the king of pop?
You read your
The song Nina took him to superstardom. The story behind the lyrics is about gang activity and life on the streets, not something Michael is familiar with, having been schooled by tutors and becoming a star at a very young age. His interpretation of two gangs coming together to rumble was based on the 1961 film West Side Story.
The story that Michael created in the song Beat It is about a knife fight involving two members of Los Angeles gangs called the Bloods and the Crips. And the peacemaker is Michael Jackson, who ends the fight with the power of music and dance. The line, "Don't be a macho man," is said to express his dislike of violence whilst referring to the abuse that he faced as a child from his father.
The music video for this song was one of the most memorable and popular of the MTV era. The song Beat It has been cited as one of the most successful, recognized, awarded, and celebrated songs in the history of pop music. Both the song and the video had a huge impact on pop culture.
Songs. and composer Paul Anka to tell Synergy 150's own story of the last 2 years. Our director, Mary Jean Hansen, rewrote the words that Paul Anka wrote for Frank Sinatra in his song, My Way. We call it Our Way. But first, a little background on our COVID time.
Remember March of 2020, when COVID-19 hit Canada? Who can forget, right? Well, we, Synergy 150, had had only 6 practices for this program when we had to stop meeting for choir practices. However, our talented director came up with a way for us to practice at home by making YouTube videos. So we could sing along with them while isolating. In fact, she made videos of every part. So soprano, alto, tenor, bass, of every song in the program. Then she even made videos of practice sessions for us. Now, think of how many songs we've sung in this program. You do the math. She made over 75 videos. This helped us stay connected until we were able to meet again for choir in September of 2021, all spatially distanced, of course, and with masks. But we at least could meet. And now, to end our program, we would like to sing for you Our Way.
Our pains, our wish.
sing our sort of song that we like to end every show with because it was written by a Canadian. So we will end our program with an encore for you of Hallelujah.